Hi, everybody. This is Mike Toole, Anime News Network Editor at Large, and I want to welcome you to Anime News Network Connect, presented by Anime NYC. We're a way to bring anime fans and the anime industry together during a time when we're all physically remote and practicing our social distancing. And today, we're very happy to welcome two of the leaders behind the new anime portal, RetroCrush, to talk about launching an anime streaming service unlike any other. Let's connect. I'm very proud now to welcome RetroCrush's Mary Gibson and Will Chao to Anime News Network Connect. Mary and Will, could you introduce yourselves?
I'll go first. I'm Mary, and I am in charge of acquisitions with RetroCrush and our parent company, Digital Media Rights. So I'm responsible for all that, for the anime that you see on the channel.
Hi, I'm Will. I'm in charge of the programming and editorial decisions behind RetroCrush. So most of the time, depending on like the creative process, social media, that's all me.
And I just want to set the tone with one question. What is RetroCrush briefly? Like, sum up RetroCrush in a sentence.
One sentence.
It's hard in one sentence.
One sentence. I know what I always write our taglines, but we're a new media streaming service dedicated to preserve the golden age of anime. It's a long sentence. Where you can watch free anime. Compound sentence.
RetroCrush is a community for old and new fans to enjoy older and maybe forgotten or unheard of gems in from you know 70s to early 2000s.
All right, great. How was RetroCrush formed?
You want to take this one, Will?
Do I want to take this one? I guess.
Yeah, I'll take this one. You do.
You're on the spot.
You know, RetroCrush was formed kind of very organically in the company. We started out, like, the company didn't start out as RetroCrush. Like, we were doing other jobs, just a lot of bunch of aggregation and digital distribution. But Mary and I, who are, you know, core members of the company of digital media rights, we were big anime fans. You know, we're about the same age. We grew up watching the same type of anime. And as we were just acquiring content from all over the place, we've always wanted to acquire more anime. And eventually, you know, slowly it happened. And it was very organic. As long, you know, eventually we just got enough anime where we're like, you know, we can actually make a channel out of this, you know. And really the core value is just to kind of expose, you know, anime from like the golden era, early 90s, late 80s, even like early 2000s, you know, to like a new type of audience, you know, for today's like streaming market. Because we kind of feel like there's sort of this vacuum for, you know, retro anime right now. And basically, that's basically how it came across.
Okay.
I'm going to second that.
So what was specifically involved in forming the core of the content when you launched RetroCrush? Was it just this kind of organic acquisition of anime for other portals, and then you realized you had this stuff on hand?
I think, you know, we didn't, you know, if the question is about like, do we have to have certain titles, we didn't think of it like that. Mm-hmm. But it was more of just like I said, like so organic in terms of realization of like, we acquired a lot of content that was very interesting and very, in a way, under-distributed, you know, especially on streaming. So that's really how it came across. Like, Mary, maybe you can go into specific titles like that kind of ticked off for you.
I mean, to get even more context, the company had been in the anime, I guess, industry, I guess you could say, previous to RetroCrush. I mean, we used to work with specific companies, I think like Funimation and Viz for specific titles for cable. So, you know, like Time Warner and things like that. So we had some kind of experience with it in the past, but with streaming, you know, at some point we, you know, we weren't really in that space and we were getting a lot of like other Asian titles, live action stuff. And it just kind of, I don't know, like just kind of circled back to that. We started getting content from Animego, and we noticed, you know, people's reactions to like Bubblegum Crisis, Vampire, Princess Mew. And it kind of grew from that. I think if in terms of like it taking off, we acquired what, I don't know how many years ago it was, last year or the year before, we acquired 12 Kingdoms and we kind of saw from that show specifically, you know, just people's reactions to it, us distributing it on like Amazon and things like that. And, you know, it just naturally came about, like maybe we should do something with this. You know, we have our sister channel Midnight Pulp that had a lot of the anime and Asian crush too. So it just kind of seemed like at the time as it was growing, we should give it its own platform and just see like how it's gonna take off. And it very surprising the reaction.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think a title like Bubblegum Crisis, you know, leading as an emblem of retro anime, I don't think you could be more apt than that. That's pretty slam bang on the target. So talk a little bit about your background as fans and professionals. Did you guys grow up watching anime?
Yeah. Yep. Don't remember what I watched first, but I do have fond memories of going to Blockbuster with my mom and my sister and finding my way to, like, I think it was like in the action section, and I would see like stuff that was animated. I'm like, well, why isn't it in this other section with all the other animated stuff? And like, I think one of the first ones I got was maybe Tenchi Muyo, and, you know, watching that and being kind of like, okay, this stuff's kind of cool. And just renting stuff and then getting to stuff like Devil Hunter Yoko, and then actually watching it and being like, maybe this is not for, like, should I be watching this? I do remember several times like telling my mom, yeah, this is cool. Yeah, I just, you know, it's like, whatever. But yeah, like, I grew up on the Blockbuster stuff, and I was always the person growing up, like, to go to for anime stuff in my high school. I'm the one that got all my friends into it, and then manga, and so yeah, I mean, it's always been a thing, and I've always wanted to do something within the space. And it just kind of randomly, I feel like it's random that it happened this way, but yeah.
Cool. What about you, Will?
Well, I grew up in Asia. I was born in Taiwan. So anime was huge. Probably just Japanese culture in general was like a big part of culture, like more so than, you know, the US. Or actually, I moved to Germany when I was 11. And then that's when I realized, oh, like, anime is not a thing everywhere. But that's also when I realized that anime was more of a, like, the subculture aspects of anime. Like, I could still find anime in Germany, and there's anime playing on the TV. Like, specific ones, like, they play Captain Tsubasa because soccer is huge over there. Or, like, Meet a Superstar. Like, sports anime was kind of big. But then I would realize, like, pockets, like, you know, you go into the downtown and you'd see, like, stores that would sell anime merch or, like, VHS back in the day. That's kind of when I kind of discovered, like, that side where anime was this kind of, like, that subculture, like the cool factor to it, rather than just like being something that's like kind of readily available everywhere, you know, like just part of daily life. It's like, that's kind of how it is in Asia. Then, you know, I moved to the States, the same thing, you know, back in the day, like I still remember what Sam Goody, you know, like,
oh,
I remember,
God,
like,
yeah,
wanting to buy VHS for Evangelion. That was a big thing, but then it'll cost like $30 per VHS, and the whole series is like, I don't know, 13, 14 VHS. You know, that's a lot of money for a teenager, but but that's kind of like that's also kind of the aspect kind of maybe we want a culture for RetroCrush. It's just like there isn't as much of that you know, personal aspect to like discover anime. It used to be like if you discover an anime, especially like in the States, I think, especially Germany, like it's like only you know about it out of your friends, and then you have to like kind of tell people. But nowadays it's just so easy, you know, to discover new things, and everybody's caught up and follows the same news. But I still think, you know, there is a little bit of that subculture vibe with like the older animes that didn't get released in the US or you know, overseas. And that also kind of really, that's a big part of what, like, what drives us, basically.
Those are some pretty good anime origin stories. I can tell you that part of my anime origin story, when I was in high school, the first like videotape I rented that I knew was Japanese animation was called Project Eiko. You can watch on RetroCrush.
Thanks for the plug, Mike.
Now, earlier you guys kind of mentioned in passing that you worked for a company called DMR. Can you go into that a little bit more? What is DMR?
What is DMR? Okay, so DMR is the parent company of RetroCrush, which also produces or manages a lot of other, let's just call them streaming channels or streaming labels in this case. And we, you know, what it is, it's just a big video aggregator for streaming licensing, you know, and that's how you know, Mary and I both got our jobs first. You know, we weren't in the business of creating, you know, niche channels like RetroCrush. We were in the business of mass distributing, you know, just anything like movies, TV shows, not like doesn't have to be anime, foreign movies. It started out with a lot of Asian films.
Yep.
That's what the parent company does and still does to this day. You know, like that's a big part of our business and what drives our ability to license a lot of the content for RetroCrush.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, like fun fact is that before we were even called digital media rights, we were Asian media rights, and we literally were only doing like Asian films and series, mostly Korean and Chinese, Japanese. And at some point, you know, we just pivoted once we got into streaming, and yeah.
Okay. Now, you know, RetroCrush, it's got retro right there in the name, but does that mean RetroCrush like exclusively pursues older stuff? Because I noticed that there's stuff on there from the 2000s, like True Tears is from 2008. So does that mean the 2000s are retro now?
It does. Oh, no. We have the final say, apparently, according to our fans. No, we get asked that a lot of times, you know, like, oh my God, is this title now retro? I feel so old. But I mean, I think I've said a lot on social media to anyone who's asked, you know, my perception of retro as a label is a bit flexible. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I don't feel like things I watched when I was a kid is retro, but you know, like the late 90s is 20 years ago, right? It's a long time ago. Mm-hmm. And when you look at a lot of the early 2000 anime too, it's closer. It's actually very like removed from like what we see nowadays, especially produced, right? It was like no CGI, no rotoscoping ever. And it felt more like, and closer to anime maybe from the late 80s than it does anime post like, you know, 2010. So that's kind of how like see retro is like, obviously, you know, we also have titles licensed from post 2010, but the general, the core values of the channel is to kind of highlight things that are kind of forgotten and under-distributed.
Okay. Yeah, to add to that, I mean, everyone's going to have their own view of what is going to be retro or not. So I kind of just for the most part like to leave that up to fans, but at the same time, you know, what Will said, part of like what drives us is the fact that we want to highlight older titles, specifically from 70s, 80s, and 90s. And you know, we have a lot of stuff that everyone's seen, and the goal, you know, would be to get stuff that hasn't been necessarily released in North America at all. And you know, just kind of expose it to people here, and it's kind of like a history of anime, of like, you know, and tie stuff that you see now to stuff that was created back in the day.
Okay, cool. So there's not really a cutoff for programming that's like, well, we can't carry this; it's too new.
I mean, we're not going to be simulcasting anything, so right, okay. I guess in that sense. Okay. That's too new.
That was kind of my question. I was a bit curious.
Yeah, no. Well, we can do that on our other channels, but no.
I think the newest thing that I saw off the top of my head was Pop Team Epic, which I think that's appropriate to be on Retro Crush because it's a show you can look at and think that's not supposed to be here. Which is
it's funny though, because that show, like,
it is simulcast.
Yeah, it
on another channel.
Well, also like the tropes and stuff. It you know, it yeah, makes fun of a lot of stuff. So. We count it, I guess.
So how did you come up with like the branding for Retro Crush, like the visual styling? I think that's really striking, like the choice of
that's,
colors.
That's all Will.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I guess that's part of my job. You know, we do wear multiple hats. For me, I'm a very visual-based person, like in my own hobbies and personal life. So for the channel, I really wanted it to have a distinct feel to capture kind of, you know, like I said, like the aesthetics of like late 80s, early 90s. I think really mostly in the early 90s is, you know, like it comes from just from what I know and what influenced me as a kid. You know, like my motto is like, when in doubt, just look at Evangelion to get inspiration. You know, pro for anything in life. But like especially visually design, like I wanted to, there's more of an organic kind of analog feel to things that we don't see as much, and like to try to find ways to recreate that and try to present it, you know, right now on like new media via OTT channels, our social media, you know, our social media content, all that stuff. It's what's kind of interesting for me personally to, you know, really that's the most interesting aspect to this job for me.
Okay, cool. Well, this is something that I know a lot of ANN readers outside the continent are curious about. I'm pretty sure right now RetroCrush is a U.S. and Canada affair. Is that correct?
Yep,
that's correct.
Okay. Any plans to go global or expand your reach, or are you focusing on right around this neighborhood for now?
Yeah, Mary, you can say the bad news.
I mean, for now, it is going to be, you know, U.S., Canada. I mean, we're baby. We literally launched not too long ago. So
like just like 5 or 6 months ago.
Yeah. And like, you know, I honestly, my heart breaks every time we like see tweets or messages like, you know, come to my country, come here, come there. Right. Because I get it. Like, these are shows that people want to see. But, the unfortunate part of it is that, you know, for right now we have to focus, you know, at home and this area. But, you know, I always tell people like the support definitely helps. And the more support we get, like I'm hoping, you know, we're able to expand, you know, to more territories and just, it just takes time. So, you know, we hear you, you know, we understand, but unfortunately, my hands are tied right now.
Right. Well, in terms of outreach, one thing for fans in North America, I can pose this question, which I think people will like the answer to. How much does RetroCrush cost?
Well,
well, it's free to watch right now. We have an advertising model, you know, and that would, you know, that's how we wanted to start a channel, really, kind of a TV experience, basically.
Yeah. I feel like that's something that fans, when they see a new streaming service, they're always cautious because they're thinking, well, I can't add another subscription. I already subscribed to these three portals.
Yeah.
But, you know, you don't pay for RetroCrush, and I think that's pretty cool.
Right. I mean, a lot of people do want to remove the ads, and we've been thinking about offering the option, obviously, just making it a hybrid. But yeah, no worries. The free streaming aspect will always be there. You know, it will never be a completely behind the paywall type of service.
Excellent. Yeah. Well, and looking at the RetroCrush catalog, I'm a big Osamu Tezuka fan, and it's like a lot of Tezuka anime on there, like the Blackjack OVAs, the Jungle Emperor Leo movie. Like, do you guys kind of have a pipeline to Tezuka Productions? Are you forming relationships with some of the content producers in Japan?
Yeah. It just happened by chance that, you know, I was introduced to contact there. And at the time, it was years ago. And at the time, we didn't even have that much anime. And, you know, we met and chatted. And at the time, you know, I think at the time we were just trying to do stuff for Midnight Pulp, but yeah, we talked and talked and talked about it. And I guess, you know, Tezuka, they like the idea of getting, you know, more content out, especially, you know, some of the lesser known works and that kind of, you know, coincide with kind of our vision for Retro. And I mean, I have the utmost appreciation for Tezuka because, you know, they've just given us so much and I love their stuff. And I have no problem watching Blackjack all day, every day. so yeah, we have some direct Japanese contacts that we work with, companies we work with, Tezuka being one of the prime ones. And yeah, I don't know what else to say other than they're just great people. And really, really understanding when it comes to like hearing us out and, you know, our vision and just taking a chance on us, to be honest. Yeah. So there's more stuff. There's more stuff coming.
Excellent. That's good news to me. One thing I noticed is you guys got a 2009 Jungle Emperor Leo movie that had a dubbed version, which kind of surprised me. Or is Was that something that you discovered was just available?
Yeah, like, you know, part of my job is I go to markets, I go to the cons, and I, you know, we have meetings and we look at avails, and I was surprised to see that available. And, you know, we talked about it and it hadn't been anywhere. So I said, yeah, you know, I wonder how this, will do. Everybody loves Leo. And I'm a cat lady, so I was all for it. Yeah, but I was really surprised, you know, reception of it, and people really liked it, and the dub. So, yeah.
Well, speaking of reception, like, what has fan response been like so far? Have you gotten some outreach from fans about how they like the channel?
I will say personally for me, I felt very confident about RetroCrush before we launched, mostly because we started off as a social media kind of entity to kind of test the waters. But I will say there was a myriad of emotions that came about once it launched, and the amount of like messages and press and like PR and reception that it got. Like, I honestly was not expecting that. And I think Will can attest to that too. And the reaction has been really, really great. And surprisingly great. and it's kind of to this day still weird feeling for me, because I don't want to let people down, and I want to, like, it's our baby, we want to keep it growing. But it's just amazing, and like, no matter what we do, you know, if we have any troubles or you know because we're still growing, people are just extremely understanding, and they're extremely patient with us, because they want to see this content. And so, yeah, the reception has been overwhelmingly positive. And it's still kind of weird for me, but like in so many good ways. Well,
yeah, I want to second that. Like, you know, I'm just so grateful for all the support, you know, like Mary, I don't know, like I didn't feel overly confident, I guess, before, just because I always expect the worst with everything I do. Hope for the best, expect the worst. Yeah, I mean, like, yeah, every day, every week, you know, because Mary and I basically, you know, like, give a shout, like, Mary basically does most of the Twitter posting herself and interact with people, and I do the same on Instagram. So, like, we see everything kind of firsthand, you know, and it's always been very, it just, so positive. Like, I mean, I'm so thankful for our fans, really, and for the community that, you know, everybody wants to see us grow and participate with us. I really think that's the yeah, big thing for me. Like, I that level of participation and just positive vibe general, you know, I'm it's really, it makes us really want to work a little bit harder on this.
Yeah.
You know, like, I have to say, like, you know, COVID's not easy for anybody. So, and for us, yeah, too, like, you know, we're still working, and we're working in a way, we kind of work in a stay-at-home business, you know, streaming and, yeah, and like, so we're very fortunate. But it still has, you know, affected the company a little bit just in terms of operations. But even through this times, you know, we missed some releases before, and people have always been very understanding. Like Mary said, like, you know, we can't thank our fans enough.
Of all the stuff that's on RetroCrush, do you guys have personal favorites? And why are they Chargeman Ken?
Well, I have to say I have not watched every single episode of Chargeman Ken. I don't know if I can do it, but I dare all our fans to try.
It's a challenge. It's one of the greatest anime ever and one of the worst.
Chargeman Ken, it's, you know, it's great to put in the background when you're doing some stuff, depending on what you want to do.
I love it for the memes.
Yeah, some of the old anime is just great for memes. It's insane. My personal favorite, you know, like, people always make fun of me because I haven't watched everything that we have. I don't think it's possible for me at this age. But yeah, a lot of stuff, I like the, growing up, like, a big influence for me was the more seinen, like the mature animes from the 80s, like the super violent ones, like Wicked City, like Demon City Shinjuku, the ones with like very dark, like demonic undertones, like a lot of times it's horror, it's a bit horror related. Those, like, because, you know, it just brings me back to, you know, like, it's like nostalgia to a point where you're in middle school, you know you're not supposed to watch it, but then, like, you know, sometimes you, in Asia, you can catch it on TV late at night. Sometimes it's just like you randomly find it, you know, illegal download back in the day. And then you watch it. And then I think those are my favorite because it really, again, goes back to like the aesthetic of it. Like, I think a lot of those titles share a similar aesthetic, and even though they're like done by different directors. And I think that for me is the most special.
I would say my favorite show on RetroCrush. I have a couple of favorites, but I always go to 12 Kingdoms. I love that show. When I first watched it, oh yeah, I remember getting my friends in high school. We obsessed with that, and to me, I fell in love with the music mostly first, and the characters and just the animation in general. Yeah. And I love those, you know, period type dramas and shows, and so that one always stuck with me as I navigated through life. And it was my goal to like get that show specifically. Mm-hmm. And so I think I posted this on Instagram, but I actually cried when we licensed that show because it was like,
that's great,
because it was so good. And like, yeah, once and like it took forever to get it, but it's like, it's just amazing to me. And a lot of people, you know, they talk about it in specific ways because of the story and when it's not even finished. But I love it. It's probably one of my favorites. And then I got to say, like, Fushigi Yugi, that's another one that I really like.
The version of 12 Kingdoms.
Yeah.
And they're both isekai anime. And those are
And I mean,
the OG.
I like Magical Girl and isekai. So my favorite thing was Sailor Moon growing up. And, you know, we don't have that, but I like all the magical like girls.
Studio Pierrot magical girl shows. You got Creamy Mommy and
yes, yeah. Creamy Mommy became a new favorite of mine. Actually, I actually am low key like obsessed with that show, and the aesthetic of it and like the music.
All right, well, let me put you on the spot with this. What in your opinion is the weirdest title on Retro Crush?
Oh,
what?
There's a lot.
Hmm.
Yeah, I know there is kind of.
I mean, there is Chargeman Ken, which I actually never watched before until we licensed it.
Yeah,
and I was like, oh.
The weirdest thing. Kaiba's can get weird.
Kaiba, yeah.
That's Kaiba is good.
Yeah,
it's good, but like some parts when I watched it for the first time, I was like, okay. But it's good. I actually like that show now that I've seen it. But I don't know what would be the weirdest thing.
I mean, I was browsing the catalog a couple of days ago to bring up talking points. I think what startled me the most was like that anime version of The Three Musketeers.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. Fiction,
magical.
Oh, fiction, interesting.
The Three Musketeers.
No, so this is good. Talking about, like, I mean, that's so not weird to me because, like I said, I grew up in Taiwan, and that was how I got to know the Three Musketeers story.
Really? So that was.
I mean, I didn't really read, like, you know, picture books or anything, like, or like, obviously not the real version when I was younger, mm-hmm. but it was just like, I think it was on when I was like 5 or 6, and then I was like, oh, cool. So I always thought Artemis was the girl until I watched the Disney movies.
Interesting.
Did I just spoil it? But whatever.
Well,
spoiler alert. So like, yeah, like for me growing up in Asia, it was really like anime was how I got exposed to a lot of like Western classic stories, even, you know, just like in terms of world literature. Yeah. I think that's the cool part too. I mean, we have a very diverse office, like people from all over the place, like Europe and South America. Mm-hmm. And what I noticed when, you know, talking to the other team members, like people who probably aren't actively working on Retro Crush, is that everyone grew up with different anime,
yeah,
depending on where they grew up. You know, if you grew up in Italy, like, or like Brazil, like you actually grew up with different anime. and like different things are popular. Like, you know, like I said, like I'm sure Captain Tsubasa is huge in Brazil, you know, but like not at all in the US. Like,
yeah.
But then like it's this huge, it's like one of the longest running manga series of all time. It's still going on since like the late 80s.
Yeah.
You know, so it's always interesting, like when we find old stuff and then realize, you know, oh, like, you know, well, we have a Cuban colleague, Danelis. Danelis would tell us, like, you know, like it's Cuba, and then like, but they have anime too, and they will watch Voltes V.
Yeah.
Voltes 5, you know, like growing up, I'm like, yeah, that was like Voltes the huge thing in Cuba. Who knew? Like, you know.
You know, people say that Voltes 5 has actually, you know, helped shift popular sentiment against Ferdinand Marcos in the early 80s because it had like an anti-authoritarian.
Oh my God, that's so crazy. And I just read about it because I know they're doing a live action series this year.
Yeah, exactly.
In the Philippines.
It's still very popular there.
Yeah. You know. That's the stuff I love about
absolutely.
Like the subculture. It's just like it's different everywhere, and you don't know all these new things.
Mm-hmm. And I see a lot of that when I go to markets and stuff, and I'm looking at avails of catalogs of stuff, and you know, I meet with people from like Italy who are telling me, oh, you know, Creamy Mommy, I love this show, but like nobody really knows it in the U.S. So it's really cool to kind of to not be able to bring that stuff here and introduce it. And, you know, some people are going to like it, some people are not. Some people are going to get it, some people aren't. But, like, it's just available. And you know, you can try something that you haven't seen before. And, like, I talk about it all the time with, like, Will and other, like, team members. But, like, that's always exciting for me when I look at stuff and think about, like, what we should get next and put up. Like, at some point, I do, like, I definitely want it to be a place where we have a lot of stuff that just never was big here and have that collection. Like Will said, he hasn't watched everything, but I'm sure, like, you go through it, you'll see something that you'll like and that would become your favorite thing. Like, I never thought I'd like Creamy Mommy as much as I do. and just, like, I want that to be kind of the feeling for, you know, fans, new and you know, older fans. So, you know, I think that's like one of the biggest, for me, the biggest drives and the biggest goals for RetroCrush.
All right, great. Well, any other final thoughts for prospective viewers of RetroCrush and the folks out there watching?
Just like, thanks, you know, thank you for all the support. Keep sending us emails about stuff you want to see. And you know, anything, you just keep sending us stuff. It does drive us. We appreciate it. You know, spread the word. and yeah, just enjoy the channel.
All right. Terrific. Well, thanks for coming on to chat with me and joining us on AN and Connect.
Thanks
for having us.
Yeah.
A massive thank you again to both Mary and Will. And to learn more, simply visit retrocrush.tv or download the RetroCrush app. We'll be back soon with another session from Anime News Network Connect. Until then, please join the Anime News Network newsletter at animenewsnetwork.com/newsletter. It's launching soon, and it will put weekly anime news and reviews right in your inbox. Last but not least, you know the drill. Smash that like button, hit subscribe, and this is ANN Editor-at-Large Mike Toole signing off.